when the sea is roaring and the rains are pouring, and my fears console me with the peace you show me.
You're never gonna let me go. Let me go. You're never gonna let me go. There is have given me freedom. Now how could I ever stop? I am stopped. Jesus in everything, you're why I sing. Your love has set me free, you're why I sing. Jesus, you make all things new.
Good morning. My name is Alan. I'm the youth and small groups pastor here at Summit Church, and I want to welcome everybody to church this morning. We are so glad you're here, and I am very excited when people come out to experience a life-giving service like we're getting ready to have, and I promise you, you're going to be glad that you came out this morning. Now, you know what? I definitely see some new guests in here this morning. So, Summit, can you help me give a warm welcome to all of our first-time guests? We are so glad that you're here with us. And one thing around here, I do not like to leave anyone out, and we want to make sure that everybody feels the love in this place. So right now, feel free to break away from your chair, find somebody, and welcome to the church this morning. Can make your way back to your seats. Thank you. Again, I'd like to welcome all of our first-time guests this morning. We're so glad you're here with us. If you look in the chair pocket in front of you, there is a green connection card that looks just like this. This card is important to us for a few reasons. The first one is you're important to us, and we want to hear from you. We want to know how your experience was from the moment you stepped out of your car till you got to your chair. The second thing this card does is this card is the only way that Pastor Eddie and the entire Summit team know that you were here with us this morning. And the third thing is exactly what the card says. We want to connect with you. And you know what? We have people that would love to just answer any questions you have about Summit, and we want to make sure that you know everything that Summit has to offer you and your family. Once you fill this out, you can drop it in the offering bucket as it goes by, or even better than that, you could take some time right after service. You could head back to our VIP corner, which is in the back left of the auditorium there. We have some great people that would love to meet you. They have some important church information they'd like to put in your hands, and we'd also like to send you out of here with some free Summit gear. So once you do that, that would be great. And then if you look right at the bottom of this card, another important feature here is we have prayer requests at the bottom of this card. If you're in here this morning and you have any prayer need, please write it down for us, turn this card in, and I promise you, our prayer team will pray for you this week. Also, in addition to that, at the end of today's service, we will have our prayer team in the back of the auditorium. If you would like personal prayer for anything, they would love to take some time and pray with you before you leave here this morning. Summit, can you help me one more time to give it up for all of our first-time guests? Awesome. Please turn your eyes to the screen.
What's up, Summit? My name is Grant.
And I'm Jenny. It's great to have you with us at Summit Church. Thanks for coming.
If you're new or have any questions about the church, come meet us at the VIP corner after service.
Here are some exciting events happening at Summit. During the month of April, every weekend will be a resurrection celebration. Summit's music team will have a special presentation telling the story of why we celebrate Easter, Jesus, our risen Savior. Be an inviter. Someone's life could be changed because of your invitation.
Take your first step to getting plugged in at Summit. If you're new to Summit, then I will invite you and your family to attend Summit Track today after 11:15 a.m. service. Along with great information in a friendly atmosphere, lunch and children's stay and play are always provided. Today's session will be step one, the spiritual journey God has for you. Jenny, I look forward to first Wednesdays every month.
Me too, Grant, and it's happening this Wednesday, April 5th at 7 p.m.
That's right, and you don't want to miss this time of worship, communion, and a powerful topic from our guest speaker, Tony Cook.
Yeah, and if you've never heard Tony Cook, you won't want to miss it. He has always given me such a fresh perspective of the Bible every time he comes. Hey Grant, did you know that he was one of Pastor Eddie's and Stephanie's professor at Bible College?
I do now, and I cannot wait to hear him. And don't forget, Summit, First Wednesdays give all of us an opportunity to be inviters to our community. It's the perfect midweek experience to let someone know what Summit is all about. So bring a friend and we will see you there. Save the dates for Summit's annual Vacation Bible School Summer Zone, happening Monday, June 26th through Thursday, June 29th. Also, mark your calendars for Summit Youth Camp, happening this July from Wednesday, July 26th through Wednesday, August 2nd.
Summit Youth is holding a series of car wash fundraisers at Summit Church. Get your pre-purchase wash tickets today and help support all of our Summit Youth experience a life-changing week at camp.
Don't miss our Easter outreach April 8th from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. as we share the message of Christ. Please wear a plain t-shirt without text or graphics. Also, join us this Wednesday, April 5th, as we prep the outreach materials right after our midweek service. Sign up at a kiosk in the lobby.
Summit gear is finally here. Stop by the Summit bookstore today and check out the different style t-shirts available for purchase. Don't forget, drinks taste better in a Summit tumbler. Also, make sure to grab a free carb magnet or sticker after the service. Summit gear is the perfect way to show your community how much you love your church.
To sign up for events, visit the kiosk in the lobby.
At this time, please silence all electronic devices. And remember, no flash photography during the service. We would like everyone to enjoy their worship experience today. Unless it's urgent, please remain at your seat until worship begins.
You can follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube at Summit Church DC to stay connected, and make sure to grab an event guide.
Thanks again for joining us, and enjoy the rest of the service.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Melissa, and I am the Summit Track Coordinator here at the church. And I wanted to come up and share with you for just a minute about what we believe at Summit Church. You see, the Bible teaches us about three important decisions that a person can make called the three baptisms. Those are the baptism in Christ, the baptism in water, and the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And we believe it all begins with that first commitment of asking Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior. And that when you've made that commitment, that you are forever changed, never the same. And the next biblical step for you is water baptism, which is the public confession of your commitment and faith in Jesus Christ. Or more simply put, we like to say around here that water baptism declares publicly that commitment that you've made to follow Christ privately. So if you're here and you have made that commitment to follow Christ, but you've never been water baptized, we want to invite you to make that public confession. You can let us know you're ready for that next step of water baptism by signing up online at a kiosk in the lobby, or look for somebody in this Forever Change shirt. We're going to walk you through this easy and fulfilling process and help you pick a date in the near future. Now, in the meantime, if you have questions regarding water baptism, there's a brochure in the chair pocket right in front of you. You can take this out right now and begin looking it over. Or if you need more information about any of the three baptisms, we have this three baptisms packet. It's located at our Forever Change table on your way out of the auditorium today. These are free resources for you. We want you to have this information. Please take this home with you if you're interested. And what we want everybody to do here today is begin to consider in your own heart what's personally your next step towards a more meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ by considering these three baptisms. And you know, here at Summit, we have been in a season of celebrating Easter and Christ's victory, and our music team has put together a special presentation for us this morning. We hope you enjoy it.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we pray.
Well, Summit, I got to speak to you just a few moments ago about water baptism. And we're so excited. This is one of our favorite parts of the service. We have two young people who have made the decision to be water baptized, publicly declaring their faith right here with you this morning. We're gonna see Sarah, she's 9 years old. We're gonna see Sydney, he's 17 years old and has made the decision to declare his faith through water baptism. We wanna share this moment with you. If you could all direct your attention over to the baptismal so you can see this moment together.
Well, everyone, this is so exciting. We have Sarah here, and she's 9, and she attends the Summit Kids. Now, Sarah, have you been born again?
Yes.
She has. And now, Sarah, why did you decide to be baptized this morning?
Because God told us all to be baptized.
All right. Very good. All right, Sarah, why don't you go ahead and put your hands over your face. Sarah, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and in the name of Jesus. Now we have Sydney here. Sydney's 17 years old. Now, Sydney, have you been born again?
Yes, sir.
Tell us what brought you to this decision this morning.
I told myself when my faith came stronger with God that I'll become baptized just for him.
That's awesome. All right. Well, Sydney, why don't you put your hands right over your face? Sydney, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and in the name of Jesus.
Shame on him who knew no sin.
Well, good morning, everyone. Why don't you stand up with me? Pretty powerful word, huh? Praise the God of Calvary. How do you thank God for what Jesus did for you on Calvary? We are so glad that you're here, and we just know this is going to be a great day. I wanted to let you know this was kind of a day in history for Summit Church. This morning was our first ever 8:15 service that we've ever had at Summit. So this is our third Sunday morning service, and so our first ever 8:15 service is now in the books, and we had somebody respond to Christ in that service, so that service was well worth, come on, let's give God some praise for that. It's worth every minute when somebody finds Christ, isn't that right? Well, I want to let you know that the music that you saw today, that over the next couple weeks, we're going to continue to just put out some Easter music, some resurrection music, and we're calling this whole month Easter at Summit. Because we think we need a little more time than just one weekend to celebrate the resurrection. How about you? And I thank God for the way that they're putting all that together. And so let's pray. Father, I thank you for what you're doing in the lives of every person here. I thank you, Lord, that as our ears are open and our hearts are in tune, that we just right now forget what's going on the outside of these walls. And Lord, if there's somebody that came in with heaviness on their heart, something going on, a pit in their stomach, something on their mind, Father, I thank you that you would begin to work in them and begin to melt away the trouble. I thank you, Father, that you're doing a work in this place, in every child, every young person, every adult, and we give you all of the thanks as we open our ears to what it is you would say to us from your magnificent scripture. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. Would you please turn and give a compliment to the person next to you? Come up with a compliment. Tell them how awesome and tremendous and wonderful and glorious they look today, and you may be seated. I would like to do one thing, and that's, you know, our 11:15 a.m. service is broadcast on the internet, so would you welcome everybody who's watching on the internet? Come on, let's welcome them. We're glad that you joined us this morning. Thank you for being a part of this service. We're excited about what we're able to do through technology. It's amazing, right? So here we are in this Easter season, and we're going to use these weeks to talk about the different elements that pertain to Easter. And as I was thinking about this morning, we were going to head towards a series that we kind of introduced last week called Risen, but I felt like I needed to spend one more week on the current series that we started last week, which is Who Am I? And the one word that would describe a non-Christian, what would be the one word that would describe a non-believer's or a non-Christian's view of the resurrection? What would that word be? And I was thinking about that. How would they view it? In other words, your coworkers, your friends, your neighbors, even your family members, what is that word that they would be looking for? And I think that word is skepticism. Because whenever we think about the resurrection, we're talking about the resurrection from the dead. We're talking about something that is bigger than anything that we could imagine that could happen on earth. When a person dies, we know that's finality. We don't go back looking for that person. It's grievous, it's harsh, it's hard. It's one of the most grievous things that happens on the earth is when we have to say goodbye to somebody. But when we go around and talk to people about the resurrection of Christ, I would say that probably everyone in here would have some skepticism concerning that. But when you get knowledge and you get understanding, that skepticism starts going away. Skepticism, in turn, can become incredulous. That word incredulous means unwilling to admit or accept what is offered as truth. People are being unwilling to accept the truth. There's a lot of reasons why we're unwilling to accept the truth. A lot of it has to do with what we've been told in the past. A lot of it has to do with some of the things that we've done in life that has caused us to maybe have a little bit of a hard shell on our life. But the Bible is a Bible and a word that has to be accepted in its fullness of truth. And when we come into this season, it's the greatest truth ever. We're talking about the resurrection of a dead man. The resurrection of someone who called himself the Son of God. And to be honest, if somebody is skeptical or somebody is incredulous about the truth, I seriously cannot blame them. You know what I want to do? I want to be able to answer them. I don't want to say, well, you're ignorant or you don't understand. I want to be in a position that I am able to answer them. How many of you want to have some information that you're able to speak to the situation and not just walk away? Well, in the light of this message, I can't think of somebody else to right now quote that would fit skepticism better than Charles Darwin, who's the father of the theory of evolution. Now, I want you to listen closely. It'll be on the screen. I gradually came to disbelieve in Christianity as a divine revelation. Beautiful as the morality of the New Testament is, it can hardly be denied that its perfection depends in part on the interpretation which we now put on metaphors and allegories. But I was very unwilling to give up my belief. Now, if I was going to be highlighting anything in his statement, I would highlight this right here. He was unwilling to give up his belief. Right there is an obstacle to being able to hear truth. Your unwillingness to give up what you believe. People will hold a belief, right or wrong. They can be unwilling to give up their belief. And this speaks to the heart of Charles Darwin, that he was stuck on what he believed, and no matter what he read outside of what he believed, he was not going to be willing to give that up. Thus, disbelief crept over me at a very slow rate, but it was at last complete. The rate was so slow that I felt no distress. I have never since doubted, even for a single second, that my conclusion was correct. I can indeed hardly see how anyone ought to wish Christianity to be true. So here we have, how do you know this is definitely the definition of a skeptic? This is definitely the definition of someone who is incredulous, who is not willing to believe a truth, even if it is true. And what I see in this statement, it's very enlightening to me, that he was not trying to prove something to be true, he was trying to disprove something. He was against something rather than being for something. And being against something, he had to stick with his belief. You know, it really takes more faith to believe in the Big Bang Theory than it does to believe in a creator who created everything out of his wonderful love. And so when we look at the scriptures and we begin to see that, we don't want to come as skeptics, but we may face skeptics. We're going to face people who are incredulous about what it is we believe. You know, it really is the craziest idea when you think about someone who predicted after 3 days of his death, the burial after that he would raise from the dead. That is just a crazy idea that he's predicting this, that he's saying this so clearly that I am going to die and I'm going to rise from the dead. And I would never want anybody to take that on face value. I have no problem with somebody challenging that because I believe it's my responsibility. I believe it's anybody who's a Christ follower's responsibility to study to the place that they can come to the place that they have a body of evidence to answer that question. How many of you would like to be able to answer a skeptic concerning the resurrection of Christ, concerning the things that they question us about our beliefs? The issue I find with Darwin's theory is that it was an idea he came to in the mid-1800s, and it was a thought that came from doubt. It was very skeptical. And if you begin to think about all the evidence that's happened since his lifetime into our lifetime, all the evidence that has come about that has pointed to the life of Christ through archaeology and through people digging things up in Israel and ideas that have come forth that weren't available to Darwin at the time. And I'm going to say this, as history continues, as we move forward and history is made, that as they dig in archaeology, it will only continue to prove who Christ really was. And so when you come from a place of doubt, all you're doing is being the skeptic. It's kind of like believing that if you sail too far on a cruise ship, you're going to fall off the edge of the earth, that the earth is flat. I put it in that same category. All created through skepticism and doubt. Timothy J. Keller made this statement. If Jesus rose from the dead, then you have to accept all that he said. If he didn't rise from the dead, then why worry about anything he said? The issue on which everything hangs is not whether or not you like his teachings, but whether or not he rose from the dead. You know, I look at this as a very interesting statement because it's just talking about one part of Jesus' life, a three-day period. That everything that went on for 33 and a half years and he was in the ministry or showed himself for 3.5 years is not as important as the last 3 days of his life. Because whether you believe his teachings or not, or whether you like them or not, you have to decide, did he rise from the dead? Because all that he did may have pointed to him being a supernatural person, but what he did at the end points to him being God. The prediction of his own death and resurrection is what we have to decide on. Now, last week, we started a series called, Who Am I? And we talked about in Matthew chapter 16 that Jesus traveled from Galilee to Caesarea Philippi, a 25-mile trek up to Caesarea Philippi, and he took his disciples there for one purpose. He took them to Caesarea Philippi because Caesarea Philippi was the hotbed of paganism. It was full of all sorts of temples and idols and different gods that people served. And he brought them there to ask him this question. And Jesus arrived at Caesarea Philippi and he asked his disciples, what are people saying about who the Son of Man is? And they replied, some think you're John. Some say John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. Some say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. Then Jesus asked them, how about you? Who do you say that I am? They were easily able to answer what other people were saying. They were easily able to put him in a category through other people of being a very highly respected person. All of the people they talked about were highly respected people in that day. Then he said, look, I get what you're saying, what they're saying, but I want to know what you think. Who am I to you? And Peter spoke up and said, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus commended him and he said, look, Peter, a teacher didn't tell you that. A book didn't give that to you. It was my Father who was in heaven who gave you that information. In other words, the belief in Christ starts from the inside out. It starts in where the heart is. Pointing back to Darwin, what did he say? He said, I will not give up my belief. What is he saying? I will not change what I believe on the inside. Right or wrong? And you noticed he said it took a long time for him to get to peace with that. You notice it was slow enough that he was finally at peace with it. He allowed doubt to fill him up so much that he convinced whole generations that what he said is true. We have to start from the inside. Now what's interesting is Jesus asked these guys, hey, who am I? Who am I? Who am I to you? You're telling me who I am to others? But I want to read a scripture this morning where Jesus talked about who he was. He told us who he was. Jesus said of himself in John chapter 11, verse 25, he said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Jesus is not asking a question. He's telling you who he is. I am the resurrection. That word resurrection means one who rises from the dead. If we were to read it just with the definition, it would say this, I am the one who controls rising from the dead. He's making a statement no one's ever made before. He's alluding to the fact that he is the one who's the giver of life. Even if somebody's dead, God can raise them up. So over the next 4 weeks, I want to spend a little time speaking to the skeptics and speaking to the ones who might be incredulous about what we're talking about. And I want to attempt to bring answers to 5 questions. Here's the 5 questions. Who exactly was the Christ? We started last week. We'll continue that this week. What happened at the cross? What happened in the grave? What happened at the resurrection? And what happened when Christ ascended? All of this is very important. Because I don't feel that a 30-minute message once a year about what happened 48 hours after Jesus was resurrected is enough to satisfy the question of the resurrection. We reserve Easter Sunday morning to come out and talk about these things, but I want to spend the time like we do with Christmas. I don't even know Christmas. Did you know Christmas begins October 2nd? Have you ever been to Walmart? Christmas begins October 2nd. You'll have your Halloween decorations and you'll have Christmas decorations in the same aisle, right? It's the holiday aisle. Well, Christmas is, we spend a lot of time building up to Christmas. There are a lot of beliefs about Christmas we know that are traditional and not even true. They're just beliefs, just like Easter. I don't even know Easter has its own beliefs. You know, today I'm not going to talk to you about the Easter bunny. You know, the strange thing is that I don't know if it's easier to believe in the resurrection or to believe in a bunny who lays eggs. I mean, you're just going to have to decide which one's the easiest to believe in. But you see, we put all of these things in these categories, and it's what people think about at that time of year. How many of you, if Easter is about the resurrection of Jesus, you want to be thinking about what the true meaning of Easter is? We always say Jesus is the reason for the season when it comes to Christmas. How many of you know he's the reason for the season when it comes to Easter? And when I look at Christmas and I look at Easter, do you know what I see? I see two bookends. And everything that happened in the middle kind of shows us that he was a miracle worker, shows us that he had an enormous amount of ability to show us God's love and all of that. But first we have to believe he was born of a virgin. I mean, that takes a lot of faith to believe that he came through a woman who had never been involved with a man. Number two, we have to believe that he was killed and 3 days later he rose from the dead. The two bookends are the most important part of your belief, not everything else in the middle. Thank God he was a healer. Thank God he was one that showed us love. Thank God for those things, but those are benefits after you know who he is. To know who he is to say, he is the Christ. He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he said, I am the resurrection. I am the one who rises from the dead. You know, Easter Sunday morning is the most attended day in America at church. So I believe we have to provide an answer for everybody who comes. I believe we should be able to speak to somebody. I don't think we should just look at somebody and say, hey, turn or burn. I just don't know that that's a good argument, right? Or how about this? Hey, buddy, you're going to hell. That is no way to win somebody. I think people are looking for credible, intelligent information so that they can believe. How many of you believe that we as Christians should be able to give an intelligent answer to the resurrection? Well, the Bible wouldn't leave us hanging, so that's what I really want to do and to study. Let's make Easter a community day. Let's invite our family, our friends, our co-workers, our neighbors, the person that works at Walmart. Let's invite them to church. But I feel a responsibility that when they're here, to give them a credible answer if they're going to make it to church. How many of you agree with that? Come on. How many of you agree that we should do that? Okay. Well, talking about Easter, I heard about this children's pastor who was sharing on Easter Sunday morning with his elementary class about the resurrection of Christ. And he asked, what happened on this day? There was no response, kind of an awkward silence. The little kids didn't know what to say. So he thought, well, I'm going to give them a hint. He said, it starts with an R. And little Gary, who was the pastor's son, lifted his hand and blurted out, recycled. Why? Because that's what he's been taught over and over again. He knows that word. Do you know it is much easier to teach on recycling than it is resurrection? It is much easier to get people to believe in recycling and let that become a very important part of their life than it is to talk to them about a person who said, I'm the one who rises from the dead. But that belief is the very key essential thing to Christianity. What you believe. This series, who am I? Who am I to you? Are you able to answer that question? And let's just see if we can go a little deeper. Luke chapter 1 and verse 30. This is when the angel came to Mary, okay? Here we are, bookend. We're going to begin at the life of Christ. This is the number one bookend. The angel says, Mary, you have favor with God. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son. You are to name him Jesus. How is this possible? Mary said, I'm a virgin. And the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will visit you, and the power of God will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. What I love about two scriptures we just read, over when he was in Caesarea Philippi, he said, what are people saying about the Son of Man? And the angel said he would be the Son of God. He's the Son of Man because that describes him as the Redeemer. He had to become man to redeem man. We had to be able to recognize him. How many of you have ever seen an alien movie, and how many of you know they're never going to look like us? How many of you know you can identify an alien pretty quick in an alien movie? Jesus did not come as an alien. He came as a human because we had to recognize him. We had to be able to look at him and say, I accept this coming from this person. Now, the Bible says that he was not a GQ cover guy, that he was not somebody you would look at and be drawn to because of his appearance, that he was an average-looking person. What made him different was what was on the inside of him. He was the Son of God. When Mary conceived her first child, the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God overshadowed her, and the child was the perfect incarnation or embodiment or living form of God in the flesh. I want you to see the outside of Jesus, and we don't have any pictures of Jesus. We have drawings of Jesus. He looks different in all of those drawings. I can't stand the drawings where they make him look like this little frail guy, you know, little arms about this big, you know, and he can barely get along. Jesus covered his ground well. I believe Jesus was a man's man on the outside. He was raised in a carpenter's home. He knew how to work with tools. That man could build you a cabinet for your kitchen. I believe that. He wasn't some wimpy little guy walking around with a halo over his head. He was a man's man. And the Bible makes it clear that in that flesh, so I want you to picture that flesh as a container, just like you have containers at home. And God poured himself inside that container, but he poured himself inside a container that you would recognize. Now you know God's pretty smart. He poured himself inside something that you would be able to look at, but now you have to have faith that that container is different than you. That what that person is saying is different than what other people have said. I want to read from a little quote from a book called The Chemistry of the Blood to Establish Something. This was written by M.R. Dehan, who was a doctor. And he said, it is a proven fact of medical science that the blood that flows through an unborn baby's vein is only produced after the introduction of the male element. The unfertilized egg within a woman does not by itself contain the element essential for production of the blood. It is only after the introduction of the male element that the blood can be produced. So what he is saying is science tells us that we get our blood type from our father. That it is biologically sound science where you get your blood from. So, if this is true, if Joseph had been the element from which Mary conceived Jesus, the Christ would have had the blood of fallen man flowing through his veins. That's why we have to see the miracle of the virgin birth. The miracle of the virgin birth is not that she was a virgin, but that the Father was God. And that putting the element of Father God in there caused him to become flesh through Mary and God through the blood. How many of you received that as truth this morning? And so as you see that, we begin to see that that fallen man's blood couldn't have been through his veins. But the blood came from God. Thus, the babe was born 100% man and 100% God in his blood and in his nature. A perfect living form of God was thrust upon humanity, and humanity did not recognize who he was. They had no idea what had taken place when we celebrate Christmas, the number one bookend, what had happened in this little dusty town called Bethlehem. On the backside of Judea, in a barn, was born a little baby that looked like you and me, but he was all God on the inside. Thus the story begins. Jesus was conceived without sin. So his natural man was untouched by the curse of fallen man. Somebody remind me the name of our series. What, it's right on the back wall. What is it called? I don't know. Who are you? Who am I? I just want to take some time over the next couple weeks. Let's get convinced of who he is. Because when you're convinced of who he is, you can convince others. Doesn't matter how skeptical they are, you'll be able to answer them with credible information. Jesus was not a mere mortal man. He was a supernatural living human being because he possessed a body like the first Adam in the garden. The Bible refers to Jesus as the second Adam. The first Adam was superhuman. When God placed Adam in the garden originally, do you know what his plan was? His plan was for Adam to live forever in the garden. That no death or disease would ever come in the garden. And then he put a tree in the center of the garden. And what did he tell Adam and Eve? He said, don't eat from this tree, but all the other trees. I just want you to know that I've coined a phrase. I believe all the other trees were called Walmart. Jesus said, you can go to Super Walmart. Come on, ladies, Super Walmart. My wife, if we're driving down the road and she sees the Super Walmart, she just looks at me and says, please. The problem with the Super Walmarts up here is they're not like the Super Walmarts down south or in the west. I mean, they lie to us what a Super Walmart is here. Because if you just go down to North Carolina and go to a Super Walmart, you're like, this is heaven. We got little, how many of you know our Super Walmarts are fake Super Walmarts compared? I mean, the ones down there, they have to have like 30 acres of land to put all of that out there. I believe that's what those other trees, God pointed all those other trees and he said, you can have any of those trees, but this one don't touch. You see, it was when man made a willful decision to disobey God that sin came into him. So I got a question for you. How many of you remember the first time ever in your life when you were young and you made a willful decision to disobey your parents or somebody? Come on, this is an opportunity. Put that hand up. Come on. And if you remember, some of you are lying. How many of you remember the first time, come on, be honest, that you disobeyed your parents? I mean, this guy's sitting over here like, you ain't going to get me to lift my hand. No way, bruh. Every one of us can go back and remember a time when mom said, after school, don't you go over to so-and-so's house. You come right home. How many of you went to so-and-so's house? Come on, be honest. Ladies, how about you? Mom said, look, no makeup. You're 10 years old, but you knew a girl that would allow you to put mom's makeup on at her house. Right? See, what am I saying? You made a willful decision just like Adam and Eve. And you know what happened? The serpent told Adam and Eve, if you eat from that tree, you won't die. God told him they would die. He said, God's lying to you. They didn't die physically. They died spiritually. Just like you and I, when we made a willful act to disobey and we knew what we were doing, at that moment, we died spiritually. We were alive as children. And the Bible says there comes a time where you make, and that's different for everybody in this room. Depends upon your maturity level and all of that. But when you make a willful decision, spiritual death comes on the inside of you. That's why Christ needed to be spiritually alive on the inside. He brought spiritual life in this same wrapper that you and I live in, so that when he did not sin, his life could be a sacrifice for you and I. He was not a mortal like you and I, but he was superhuman. He would have continued to live on and on. It was not until he hung on the cross that he became a mere mortal man, because it was at that moment he became sin, and the law of sin and death killed Jesus. Think about it. He had God's blood running through his veins. There's no way sickness could have got in him. There's no way disease could have got in him. He would have never gotten old because he had God's blood in his veins. So he was a superhuman. Now, I realize this takes a little bit of thought. You have to think, well, is that true? But if you think that God's blood was running through his veins, how many of you know he was the most healthy person that ever walked the earth? And there was no way that something could touch God. And so he had to make a decision to say, hey, in heaven, he said, look, I'll become a man. I'll go to earth. I'll live 33 and a half years. And I will willingly take on sin. And that sin is what killed his body. Romans 7:5. Let's look at this in the scripture. In the past, we were ruled by our sinful selves. The law made us want to do sinful things. Isn't it funny when you're told not to do something, it's what you want to do? Mom's baking cookies. These are for your aunt and uncle. Don't touch them. Instantly, you're like, forget aunt and uncle. Right? Drive down the road. The sign says 55. You look down. 58. That's cool. Right? There's just something about it. Wet paint. Don't touch. What do you want to do? You want to pull the paper up, touch behind it, and move on. There's something in our nature that makes us want. The Bible says we were ruled by these sinful things in our bodies so that we did what we did only brought us what? Spiritual death. This is exactly what happened in the garden. So let's look at the antidote. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. Christ had no sin, but God made him to become sin for us so that in Christ we could be right with God. He took on our sin. He had no sin, but he willingly said, I'll take your sin. I want you to picture that for a minute. He willingly took on all the sin from Adam to him and from him on the cross all the way forward into the future. He said, I will take all that sin. Why could he carry that load? Because he was sinless. It wasn't his body, it was the blood. The Bible says that when the blood is shed, there's forgiveness of sins. That is why you will see that the Israelites and other pagan beliefs, but the Israelites especially because of what God has said, through the blood of animals, they would have their sin covered. So they kill animals. And that blood comes out, and they believe it covers their sin. But you know what the blood of Jesus does? The blood of Jesus doesn't cover your sin. The Bible says once and for all a sacrifice was made for you and me. It no longer covers your sin. It washes your sins away. God's blood was shed so that we could be forgiven. He had no sin, but God made him to become sin for us so that in Christ we could be right with God. See, it's in Christ. It's kind of like, here's Christ and here you are. You're sinful, but he's sinless. He died for your sin even though he was sinless. He still died for your sin. And he comes over when you accept Christ and he covers you. And now you're in Christ and no longer can your sin be seen. It's washed away, gone. And even if you make a mistake, you can say, Father, forgive me. And his blood will perpetually continue to cleanse you because of the power that's in that blood. Jesus' non-sin nature gave him dominion over the laws of nature and over the law of sin. You ever notice that Jesus could stand up in a boat and speak to the wind? He could speak to the rain. He could speak to the storm. Jesus could walk on water. Jesus could do things that you and I could never do. And we wonder, how did he do that? Because he had the control over these things because he had a nature of God in him, not a sin nature. We have a baptism tank full of water here. I would love for somebody to come up here and walk in that stuff. You're going to go right down. Why? It's the sin nature that we have that keeps us from being able to walk in the place that Jesus did walk because he was sinless. But he paid a price so that you and I could be free from that sin nature. In the eyes of the average person, what Christ did is a miracle. That he could take all of that sin. I mean, that is a huge miracle. He could take all the sin of the world, he could put it on himself, and he could forgive all that sin. But in the eyes of God, it's normal. It's not a big deal in the eyes of God because he knows what his power can do. And so many times the enemy will blind us and make us feel like God won't do it for us. The whole reason Jesus came was to forgive your sin. The whole reason Jesus came was to make a way for you. And so what are we doing this morning? We're trying to open our eyes. What is this Easter season all about? Not bunnies who lay eggs. I have no problem with that. But I want you to know the truth. Why? So you have a credible answer to whoever it is you work with, to whatever your friends or your neighbors or your coworkers are saying when we mention Easter. Think about who was walking among the religious leaders of that day. The promised Redeemer, God in the flesh. The one they had been waiting for, but they didn't know who he was. they didn't even recognize him. John 12:37 speaks to this. Even after Jesus had done all these miraculous signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. So what is this saying? This is saying that miracles could happen right in front of you. You will be impressed for a second, but later on you'll go off and maybe not even think about it again. Miracles in themselves will not cause you to be a believer. It's what Jesus did in the beginning and what he did at the end. Being born of a virgin and rising from the dead. See, all of those miracles he did, they didn't impress anybody. They did not believe. Now, there were the common man that believed, but it's talking about the religious leaders. So Jesus had to perform one more amazing act to prove who he was. That was the act of what? Resurrection. He had to show that he was God. He said, "You kill me, and 3 days later, I am resurrection." Right? I am Iron Man. Everybody loves a superhero. Why do we love superheroes so much? We love superheroes because they defy the odds of gravity. They defy the odds of trouble. They can take down the bad guy. My favorite scene in a Superman movie, one of the newest Superman movies, you know, all of these kids now are really excited about the Avengers like they're new. But man, there are 60-year-olds who used to read comic books. Do you know what a comic book is? They used to read comic books about the Avengers. There's nothing new about superheroes. Jesus was the only true superhero who lived on the earth. He was the only one who came and could set man free. But I remember this scene in a Superman movie, and he flies on top of this building, right? He can defy the odds of gravity. And there's a guy up there with a Gatling gun, and he's shooting this Gatling gun, and all of these bullets are coming out, and the gun's getting really hot, and he's walking towards him, and the bullets are bouncing off his chest. How many of you have seen that? Come on, be honest. Some of you aren't being honest. Too spiritual to watch movies. Come on, let's see. Right? And they're bouncing off. And remember, the Gatling gun ran out of bullets, right? And so he pulls out his 9mm and he fires off one bullet. Pow! And this bullet, slow motion, goes through the air. And there's Superman standing, and the bullet goes straight for his eye. And this little 9mm bullet hits the pupil of his eye, and it sandwiches to a little piece of metal and falls to the ground. He's like, "What's up?" Just talking about it gives me goosebumps. What am I saying to you? We love superheroes because of that. Can I say to you, Jesus was the only real, true superhero because he took something more than bullets. He took the weight of your sin. He carried it into hell so that you could be forgiven. God made him to become sin so that we could be made right. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 says this: non-Christians can't understand or accept what the Holy Spirit teaches. They sound foolish to him because only those who have the Holy Spirit within them can understand what the Holy Spirit means. Others just can't take it in. The leaders of Jesus' day hated him rather than believed in him, and they engineered his death behind closed doors. So Christ, through his death, became our substitutionary sacrifice for our sin. And he was able to fulfill that role because he was sinless, and he was able to carry our sin. The Bible says over in Isaiah that he was despised and rejected. I love the end of this verse. It says, "We turned our backs on him and looked the other way as we went by. He was despised and we didn't care." Think about what that says. They despised him to the place of death. And so I want to read to you one more scripture. And I want to show you that Jesus literally was superhuman. He could have lived forever. And he, even with his own words, made a statement in the scriptures that proves that he could have lived forever. John chapter 10 and verse 17. "I freely lay down my life, and I'm free to take it up again. No one takes my life from me." Do you know how many times he tried to kill Jesus in the scriptures? And how many of you know he was like, "Can't touch this." Da, 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 da. How many of you remember that? I swear I'm going to wear some hammer pants one day. I'm going to do it. They tried to kill him multiple times. They could not touch him because he had the power over death. The only reason that Jesus died was because, look, he said, I have the right to lay it down, and I also have the right to take it up again. Are you ready for this? I received this authority personally. I want everybody to read these last three words on the screen. Personally, from where? From who was his father? Where did he get his blood from? He had supernatural blood that made him a supernatural being on the earth, yet he came in the container of flesh so we would accept him. And the flesh had to come that way because the flesh had to die, and the only reason that flesh died was because he allowed sin to come on him. Can you see that scripture says he had control over whether he lived or died? Not only that, he had control over when he died to rise again. He said, I do this because I'm doing it for you. No one could kill Jesus. Instead, he chose to become sin for us. Would you stand up with me? He chose. He made a choice for you, for me. You know what else he made a choice for? Your friends, your family, your co-workers, your neighbors. Superman gives me goosebumps. Jesus cuts me to the heart. Superman looked good in tights, but Jesus was an unrecognizable supernatural force who laid his life down willingly so that you and I could live. I like to call him the greatest weightlifter ever. Some of you guys in here, I'll come and greet you and I'll grab your arms. I'm like, whatever. You know, rock hard, you know. As strong as a man can be, he cannot lift his own sin. He cannot deal with the weight of the pain that he creates in himself. Why is that? The curse that came from our father Adam. The second Adam came. And willingly, he didn't come to live forever and get old. He came to lay his life down. Freely for you and me. Could I ask you to bow your head and close your eyes? While you do that, I want to read this statement from Brennan Manning. For me, the most radical demand of the Christian faith lies in the summoning the courage to say yes to the present risenness of Jesus Christ. I want to ask you, have you brought forth the courage to say yes to the risenness of Jesus Christ? Because his resurrection is what proved that he was God. Not the miracles that pointed to God. Not all of those supernatural things, those pointed to God, that he was capable of working through a man. It was his death, burial, and resurrection where he said, I rise. And I've left your sin in the grave. So the question today is, who is he to you? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? I want to give you an opportunity to find him right now. If you're here today and you say, I've never made a decision for Christ, what does that mean? I've never prayed a prayer personally out of my own mouth to ask Christ to forgive me of my sins and to make him the Lord of my life. If you've never done that, this is your opportunity. This is it. If you're here today and you say, I have made a decision like that in the past, but I'm not serving him like I know I should be, you know what I say? Come on home. On either two of those invitations, whether you've never prayed a prayer, I'm not talking about your friend, your neighbor, your grandmother, what they've done. I'm asking what you've done. Who is he to you? He has to become the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Today's your day to get the weight off of your shoulders. Let Jesus become the King in your heart. What I'm going to do is I'm going to count to three, and I'm just going to clap my hand together like that. And if you're here today and you say, hey, Pastor, will you pray with me, pray for me? I just want you to throw your hand up. Every head will be bowed. Every eye will be closed. No one will be looking around. We won't single you out or pull you out of your chair. You say, well, then why do I need to lift my hand? Because I believe when you do that, you're recognizing with an action the decision in your heart. And I believe the chains begin to snap off your life when you just lift that hand up and say, hey, pray with me and for me. So here we go. Get ready. This is your opportunity. This is your moment. Don't miss out on it. We're not going to embarrass you or pull you out. So here we go. One, two, say, I need Jesus. This is your opportunity right here. Three, just throw your hand up and say, that's me. God bless you back there. God bless you here. God bless you. I see you. I see you. I see these hands. God bless you. Up in the mezzanine, I'm looking around. I'm looking around. You say, I wish I'd have lifted my hand. Just lift it up right now. Right here, right now. Thank you for that hand right over there. God bless you. We love you. Thankful for you. Anybody else? I'm going to pray, but I don't want to leave anybody. Say, I wish I'd have thrown my hand up. Just throw it up real quickly right now. We just want to pray for you. We believe this is a life-changing moment right here, right now. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to pray a prayer, and I'm going to ask everybody in this room to pray this prayer and repeat it after me out loud. Those who lifted their hands, please pray it loud enough that you can hear it with your own ears. This is a decision that's made in the heart, and confession is made with the mouth, but you won't be singled out because everybody's going to pray this prayer. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I realize today my need for a Savior, and I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe He was born of a virgin, that He died on a cross, He was buried in a grave, and 3 days later He rose again. Jesus, I ask you now to forgive me of my sins. I make you the Lord of my life. Thank you for being my Savior. And I invite you to come live in my heart. And from this day forward, I say about myself, I'm forgiven. I'm changed. I'm a Christian. And I will never, ever be the same. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's give God some praise in this house. I want you to shout out on three that Jesus is my superhero. One, two, three. Come on, let's give Him some praise. Come on, let's give God some praise. Jesus! So we're going to spend the next couple weeks talking about this. We're going to answer some more questions next week. Come, we're going to start our new series next week, Risen. It's going to be really, really cool. We just want to make sure that this season is something you're so able to answer any question about, armed and dangerous with the truth. Amen? Amen. What we're getting ready to do now is we're getting ready to go to worship. There's a prayer team at the back of the room if you'd like to get prayer. Those of you who lifted your hand, someone's just going to come tap you on the shoulder, and they're going to hand you a packet about this size. It says Next Steps on it. That Next Steps packet, you've taken one step. We want you to know about the next step. That packet is going to really, really help you out. It's got a CD in it. You can pop it right in your car and listen to it on the way home. A CD that my wife and I put together specifically for this purpose. There's books in there, some information about the church. It will really, really help you. So receive that as a gift from us. The rest of you, right before we leave here, how many of you would like to worship the King that sets you free? Come on. Let's begin to worship Him.
You put your love on the line to bear the weight of sin that was come on, lift it up today. With all
Well, you may be seated. I'm Tony. I'm the executive pastor.